Like I said, just a few other notes. One correction, I was creative director there. Make sure that gets out there. But anyway, and I love working at Media Current. Very, very, very open-minded company. He did a thorough job of covering kind of my background. So, you know, some of my favorite sites in Drupal that I've worked on and developed is SavannahNow.com, and also GMCLife.com, that's another gospel music channel. And YMIB.com is some of my favorite projects, some of the bigger projects. That's it. BFA, and I'm a creative guy through and through. You know, I have a fine arts degree, so I'm backing into Drupal from a creative perspective, not a programmer. So please don't throw little pebbles or rocks at me if I, you know, don't get some programming me right. I'm sorry. I'm a creative guy, okay? So this presentation is for, you know, if you need a basic idea of where to begin, you know, if you need to understand the process of turning a Drupal design, or just the concepts involved, turning a design into a Drupal theme. If you just want to make existing improvements on a Drupal site, you know, we'll touch on basic points. But at the end, though, if we need to break, you know, from this platform, we can always, you know, have a local download copy of Drupal, and we can just, you know, ask me a question. If I can answer it, I just try to go from there. Can everybody hear me?
Yep.
Hey, okay, all right. So, again, it's broken out. We're gonna cover tools, you know, common things you use creating a Drupal design and theme, you know, how to look at it from a Drupal way, Drupal eyes, so to speak, and common techniques and practices that I have picked up over time that seem to work for me. You know, seem not to aggravate the people around me, so I stick with it. More or less, it's a good idea to change if it aggravates people around me. This is, you know, personal note. So this is the general layout, how I want to cover these topics. Write tools, design theme concepts, and common theme techniques. So let's just get into the first topic. Very important in anything in life in general is to use the right tools. Ideally, if you have the wrong tools, your project will frustrate you and also the people around you. It's like kind of trying to build a house with a spoon and a fork. You know, you see somebody out there with those materials, you know, right there, they're not really, you know, they're not going to do the best job for you, so you may want to go the other way. Tell you a little bit about the tools that I use, and some of you may use. Now I don't know everyone's skill level in here, so I'm just kind of splatter out, you know, information. You may be familiar with it, you may not. For those who are, please bear with those who are not. Photoshop. Show of hands, everybody know how to use Photoshop? All right. So everyone is not as familiar. Photoshop is a good tool to do a page layout. And it's not terrible, you know. You don't have to run from it. FileWorks is a better tool. And I'm going to go through each one of these, but just in general, these are just icons that represent each tool set. Of course, the ones on the right are on left, my left, browsers. And most of you guys, some of you guys use this guy. Don't talk to me.
We don't allow those developers in that group.
Yeah, that guy, it's not a good guy. We need to sign a petition or something to get them off the
But there's nine coming out.
Yeah. I don't know, guys. I gave up on them a long time ago. Just a brief overview. I'm going to skip through some of these. Again, you know, the basic strong points of Photoshop is universal. Most people have it. Most people that you work with will be able to interact with, open up files and such in Photoshop. So most designers will have this on hand, so it's a good idea to use it. It has, you know, decent exporting, you know, from, you know, there's a process when you have to, what they call slice or cut up a design and export it, you know, to get the images out, and you steal the images out. It does all right with it. A better tool for that would be Fireworks. And you guys, how many of you guys use Fireworks? You used to? Okay, well, I go back and forth. It depends on the team that I'm working with. You know, if I know that, you know, if I know that the people that I'm dealing with, and you have to use the right tool for the group you're with. If they don't use Fireworks, I tend to use what everyone else has so I can pass files back and forth without problems. I mean, it's okay. They open up, it'll do a decent job of opening up. If you take a Fireworks file, and we have to save it a certain way and open up the Photoshop, but you lose some, in some cases, transparencies and some of the richness of the design, more or less. But for those who are anti-corporation, you know, you may know that guy. He's a friend of everybody who hates corporate America. But he's there if you need him. He's GIMP, and it's powerful. It's powerful now, but at the same time, if you know Photoshop, it's a different learning curve because they do it a totally different way, but it's free, and it's still, again, it's very powerful. I wouldn't necessarily discourage you not to use it. I may give a talk about it later if you guys really want, you know, want to know. This guy, Illustrator, it's, you know, you guys had a question about logos. This is a good tool for what they call vector artwork.
We do vector.
Vector, okay, all right. Yeah. Vector artwork, that's basically where it's drawn by math. So you don't have to worry about, you know, pixel resolution. You can expand it as far as you want. And it's a good program, especially when you, in Drupal, if you want to take a logo and resize it. You can do it in Photoshop too, but you know, you could open up Illustrator and get everything prepared and prepped and prep to import into a...
Can you do some of the same things in Flash?
Can you do, yeah, Flash is inherently a vector-based program. Do you need to? No, but you know, you can do it.
What about Inkscape?
Is that Inkscape? Oh, I forgot. That's a good one. This is the equivalent to those who hate corporate America again and Adobe. Inkscape is the way to go. And it's very powerful too. And, you know, it's a fairly decent conversion, you know, when you open up an Illustrator file in Inkscape. I mean, you know, as long as you're not doing anything complex like gradient meshes and doing something, you know, extremely radical with it, it's pretty decent. So we're going to get a little bit into browser tools that you can use. Firebug. I know everybody should use Firebug, right? Everybody knows what Firebug is all about? And they got an excellent promotion strategy to say everybody knows about it. So just a brief overview. You know, you can edit the web right in Firebug, but it's pretty good. And you just, it plugs into Firefox. You have to, this guy here, this is my friend. I like this guy too, but I like both of these. I use both of these. The Firefox, that's what they call, they make plugins. And this is a plugin, and this is what it looks like. So you can go in and say, hey, you know, what's going on here? And you click on that guy, and you click on here, and then it'll show you exactly what's going on in the code. And it'll allow you to edit in place, so you can kind of do on the fly edits. Without having to go, you know, even if you have the local, it still saves you time because you can do a lot of prep right there.
I have a question. If you're looking at a website and you want to say how big is that box?
Oh yeah.
What's the fastest way to do it?
Oh, see, there's I can show you live right here layout. You what you do is you click on here, and I'll show you later. You click on this is what they call an inspector.
Uh-huh.
Like inspector gadget. But you know, you inspect something, and then it'll highlight here, and then you can click over here, and then it give you the size, the padding, what they call padding, the space inside of the box, and the margin space outside of the box, and the border width, so space in between. That's where I can put that. So it's a pretty good tool. It's a must-have for anybody who wants to become a, if you want to live in that world between designer and themer, and let me tell you something about themers. Obviously, you're hybrid type of person. You know, you're not quite creative. I mean, you can be, but you're not quite a programmer. You're just a middle child. You know, like Brady Bunch, you know, you're just in between two worlds. You never really get the attention you deserve all the time because the creative guy steals, and I happen to be the creative guy, but the creative guy steals and the programmers get. So you're in between two worlds. But it's okay to be there because you always got a job. Everyone needs somebody to do this, sure. This is another plug-in for Firefox. Web development. This is an entire toolkit. I mean, you can. It's like before Firebug got popular. You know, this is a tool you use, and you can do pretty much the same thing you can do in Firebug. It has good validation tools, meaning you want to make sure you always validate, and it'll actually validate as you refresh the page. You can see it. It's not on here, but I can show you. I'll show you when I open up the browser later. Just remind me, and I'll show you how it works. It's a pretty good tool, and you can put all types of information about it. Another good one I didn't put up here is called YSLO. Everybody familiar with YSLO? And that's performance-based type of tool, and it also, you know, it just allows you to see how fast, you know, how much your CSS weighs, how the files are working together. It's a good little performance tool. Yes.
W-H-Y. Why the letter?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right.
Never heard.
Yeah, go.
That's
why. Huh?
It's from Yahoo.
It's Yahoo, yeah.
Oh.
You have to put that exclamation point in there. Real particular about that. Believe me, I know in design you have to be familiar with all the rules and regulations when you're dealing with corporate brand. So this is a good tool, and you can just go on Firefox website and download it, and do a search for web development, and you get that. And these are the browsers. We talked about that before. Everyone doesn't use IE, right? It's not. Yeah. What's that?
You discourage your clients from using it.
Yeah, it's just not a good. Oh, I'm sorry. I guess I can't badmouth, but I can't. It's my show. Sorry. I don't like it. So, you know, but most people use it. So, my typical process that to get the job done, I use Firefox and Chrome just when I'm developing. And then the latter stages, I go to this guy and make sure it's clean. Everything's clean. The typical rule is if it's what they call semantic, valid HTML, you really probably wouldn't have a lot of problems with IE if you do your code correctly at the outset. One of the tricks that I'll show you later, how you can ensure that you start on the same footing for all the browsers, what they call a reset, and I can show you a little bit later what that's about and what contributed themes are out there that have that built in already. And two other items is what they call a color picker. Now for those on Mac, this is the color meter, and you can pin drop anything in the OS on the screen and it'll give you the hex value. Because typically in web you use hex. You can use RGB, but this is a good tool. But for those who are not fortunate to have Mac, I said that. What they call ColorZilla. That's another Firefox plugin, right? And you just go online and research it, and you can click that this button here, and a little eyedrop pin like that will show up. And you just scroll around and you pick the right color, and you can do a right click on it. See, it even shows you. You can't see it with brother, but it'll even show you right there what the hex value is, and then also you can copy it right from the UI into your design. It saves you gobs of time. You really don't have time to go back through your style sheet and find that color over and over again. If you're fortunate to have a style guide, that a creative gives you, but most times you just need it quick and dirty. So that's an easy way to do it. Now, the next thing that's Drupal related is what they call a theme developer module. This is a good tool if you, what they call template suggestions and variables. See, if you wrote, it has an inspection tool. You know, it's in the lower, my right hand corner. It's a little box, and you click it, and then this guy pops up, and you can roll over it anywhere on the Drupal page, and it'll give you all the variables and the particulars about what's being rendered there.
It's so, like Firebug for Drupal.
It's Firebug for Drupal, and it's pretty good. I mean, you know. If you want to travel the rough and rugged road of being a thinker. this is what they were telling you about, the internal staging, what they call it, a LAMP stack. This installs all the PHP, MySQL, and Apache. Everything you need to kind of run your local site, a Drupal local site, so you can do testing, which I recommend you download your site. Get this, this is only for Mac, but get, XAMPP
and WAMP.
WAMP for Windows. And it basically gives you a server on your heavy duty laptop there. Right. Thought I forgot. Heavy duty laptop there. And it allow you to test your site so you can switch out those modules and test, you know, to see if it's really gonna, if it may damage anything on your site, so to speak. Now, you know, this rule of thumb, I'm a creative guy, from what I overhear from real developers, is that you can never get two environments exactly the same anyway, but this is a typical way you can try.
Actually, it's also got a product called DAM as well, which does the same thing.
What's it called?
It's called DAM, and okay. It does exactly the same thing, but it also pre-downloads all the appropriate modules for an install. And it runs on Mac, PC, and Linux as well.
Wow.
That's
okay,
cool.
I'm writing that down. Let me go check it out.
Which is called DAM.
It should have come up with a different word, you know what I mean? Yes. Damn, it never sounds good.
It doesn't sound marketable. I mean,
it's like moist.
Matrix's website is actually running on that.
What's that?
I have no idea. I guess now we need to go.
It's running on there?
Yeah. Go to WAMP.com.
Yeah. All right, well, that's a good tip. Thank you. I did not know. I was not aware of that. That's why I like having smart people in my audience. Okay, this is the second part of the design to theme concept. Okay, these are some of the familiar terms that you may hear your developers or somebody over time, you may hear these conversations. These are some of the words that they may use, like hooks, what are hooks, and not for fish. They're really for the ability to give the modules and themes the ability, so you can hook into the site and get information back, pass information back and forth in the site. That's the best way I can say that. Pre-process functions, what they do is they basically grab information and insert it before the entire thing loads. It puts it in there and makes it available. Theme functions obviously is for theme what they call overrides, things that Drupal has what they call default core items, and you use what a theme function to override those core items without going into core, because you never want to hack core. And what that really means is that don't touch anything that's not inside or that's outside the site's folder. Okay. Everything outside, if you look at a Drupal directory, which we'll look at in a few, everything outside of that is what they call core. Okay? Don't touch it. More or less. So, right?
So you'll break it.
Oh, you may see the reason why is that, you know, what they told you, man, they said, you know, don't worry about updating it. You know, well, I don't know. They may have, I don't know, but they may have touched something in court that they shouldn't have, may or may not. I'm speculating here, so please don't take that as a, you know, don't call them. I got a guy, he told me, don't. Right? I won't back you on that one, okay?
Well, maybe he just wants
you
to keep paying him for
the template. Yeah, it looks like he wants to keep paying you, but the template files are what Drupal uses to display content. That makes sense. And regions are areas on the site that you can put content in, and those are where content lives, so to speak. It's how Drupal organizes its information. Boxes are bits of information that you put inside of regions. Content types, they're pretty much like the, they pretty much help you describe the type of data that you're putting into nodes. The taxonomy is another way to organize it. It's a, it comes from a librarian, with a librarian, like ancestry, or origin. It's, yeah, it helps you organize. It's like tags.
Drupal work with tags.
So, yeah, it's pretty much Drupal work with tags. And, I'm going to get through this. This is a lot. It's like being in school. The teacher's like, get to this. template.php is where you put information that you don't want to put into a module. It's just typically, it's how I look at it. It's just really where you put quick functions and theme functions and pre-pos functions, things like that, that you don't want to build a whole module. They don't really belong anywhere particularly. And views are, it's like SQL for Drupal. And CCK is filled with data, that you can specify certain data for nodes. So, one last thing, the menu system is the key in Drupal. It's well beyond just what it implies. Like, it's not navigation, it's how Drupal pulls in nodes and information, or how it categorizes it, so to speak. So this is a more graphical view of the autonomy of a Drupal template. I was talking about regions. These are red areas. These are regions, right? These guys, these orange, these are what you can call blocks, right? These are all could be blocks. And these are what you can call nodes. So that's pretty much how, and you can control all that in what they call the dot info file. And I'll show you that when we get to the live version. So, everybody knows about Granddaddy Garden, right? There's nothing wrong with Granddaddy Garden. You just gotta know how to treat it, and know how to talk to it, because you can make a beautiful theme from Granddaddy Garden if you know what you're doing. It's like surgery, if you just wanna get up and start going. These are some of the things, I roll my own, but I create my own themes. I tend not to use more or less a contributed thing, but sometimes I do. If I just really want to get the job done, I got to get it out of the door, I may just throw something in there. And I run through a few of the things that I consider a decent, approachable. It's for different skill levels, different things. For beginner, Garland will pretty much have, they will have pretty much everything you need. Some will argue that you can use Zen, but it's kind of like using a shotgun to kill a fly. This is really heavy, in my opinion.
Dante, are you saying that the Zen template is heavy in HTML?
I'm saying that.
Or all the other stuff that you get with it?
I'm saying you get a lot that you didn't ask for. If you ask a typical beginner, I'm not talking about advanced users. I'm just saying somebody who's just like, I promised my son-in-law, my daughter-in-law to put up a wedding site. And if somebody says, well, go download Zen, it's wonderful. And they look at that CSS, it's like 12 or 8 CSS. And it can be daunting, more or less, if they have to customize it, more or less. But again, this is my personal opinion.
It's not very clean, where it comes to. I've never thought the CSS was very clean at Zen.
It's it could be weighty, but I know it got the top theme award or something like that. Now, me, I'm a radical. I don't follow trends, and that's something I'm going to talk about very heavily. I don't really get into just because everybody's doing it does not mean it's the right way to go. It just means that everybody's doing it, you know, once upon a time. And I'll show you once upon a time a little bit later. These are some of the things that I have created. The GMC site, this will be launching very soon, within a week or two, so you guys can check it out. I did the front-end design. Again, we have a team of people at Media Current, so I didn't touch all the back-end, but nevertheless, it's still superb, in my opinion, or the theme layer, so to speak. I work at in different capacities. But this is a typical theme. And Drupal that you can do. This is AutoTrader site that we did, which came out pretty nice. And this is in Drupal from the Drupal theme. This is University of Georgia. This is another Drupal theme that you can pretty much do anything. Just like Dave was saying earlier, you can pretty much do anything you want, more or less in Drupal. I haven't figured out how to win the lottery yet in Drupal, but I'm working on that. Let's see, Ad Giants, that's another clean or Drupal theme. And this was built using panels. We can get into that a little bit later. So there's a variety of ways that you can arrive from Granddaddy Garland to this. If you take your time. Now, remember I told you about that wing? Now, how many of you guys lived through the 80s? Now, you know, that's what I'm saying. Everybody was doing it, but you won't pull this out of me, and you're not proud of it nowadays. So that's my point. Just because everybody's doing it does not mean, the hairstyles, because everybody's doing it, doesn't mean that it's a classic decision. You want to make classic decisions when you do a Drupal design, or consider using modules and themes and things like that. Now, I'll give you another example. I was that guy. This guy right here. I was that guy. Okay. I'm not gonna show you no pictures. I just tell you where I got it from. But I was that guy. So no, I didn't go there. I had a girlfriend, and everybody called her Juicy. But I was there anyway. She was, my
so you were person. You were definitely a kid and not.
Yeah. For my hair, I had Gumby, and I had Gumby. That's why I know. I'm coming from experience here. Don't do it.
Was it this way? I do have a question, though, in regards to Drupal, staying away from trends and not doing what the masses are doing.
Yeah.
But to the flip side of that, though, isn't there an advantage to doing that? Because Drupal is kind of a community. So, for instance, Zen has a hard CSS that's already compatible for Internet Explorer, which the beginner may not know.
Well, no, I'm saying that. Let's get okay. Seriously, reality is use what's comfortable for your group and work environment. Right. See, if everybody in your group they don't use Zen and they're not comfortable with it, you may be, but they can't work with you because they're not really fluent in it. That's what I'm trying to say. I'm saying that you should only when I say stay away from trends. I'm saying that don't make decisions just because everyone is doing it because it may not be the right decision or may not be the best decision for your particular project. You have to weigh both options. I'm not saying don't use it because it's just wildly bloated. In my opinion, I'm just saying that if it works for your particular environment, use it because you guys will share a common language. That's really what you should do in any environment.
Yeah, Zen Classic was really bloated, but they quit doing it now. They've got different versions of Zen each time.
So Zen is broken out all the way. And I'm saying, this is my presentation in the sense that I'm giving you my viewpoint of it. But like I said, never, and this goes for anybody, always weigh what is being said. you know, there's, just like Photoshop, there's a thousand ways to do the same thing. So you're going to get somebody, any presenter, they're going to tell you, do it this way, it's the best way. Of course, it's their advertisement, it's what they're trying to sell you, it's their bit. But from my personal experience, and I'm going to show you some ways that I code, that I have found more or less works for the environment that I'm in. I haven't gotten any hate mail because of people working with my code, so I guess I'm going to keep doing it until somebody puts me out, puts me away. But
on the total flip side of that, how do you deal with the other side of the coin, the marketing managers and the sales guys that have promised all this great, crazy stuff to a client, and it's all trendy?
It's all trendy. Well, as a creative, you deal with that all the time. People come in and know just enough to hurt you and themselves, you know, with it. And the problem is, what you have to do is education. This is a great time to always educate. And sometimes you learn something new. You know, it may be a new trend. You may not have seen that before. You may have seen it, but you may not have had to deal with it. And the client may bring it to you, and then you get a new perspective about it. Like Fusion. I had to use that.
Skinner.
Yeah. So I had to use that, and I had some pluses. You know, I really like it. But you know, did I change my entire program? No, but I know that it's a tool. I use it when it needs to be used, and take it out of the box. You know, you want to use the right tool for the situation. So how, to answer your question more clean. Basically educate the person, ask them why they want to use it. And sometimes it's just because my brother-in-law or my so-and-so told me that it was the best. You can, in a subtle way, you can ask the question of, well, have you thought about this? You know, have you thought about this? Like, you know, you can ask a question that will lead them to a natural conclusion that maybe I'm overreaching here, or maybe, you know, I should take your advice on X, Y, Z.
Mostly, like marketing automation and stuff like that coming to us from trying to improve click-throughs and stuff like that. It gets back to the trends that they're working with in those matters.
Yeah.
It's a balance sometimes.
The main thing, I guess the main overall point, the takeaway, put this down right in your book, is always look for the classic solution, not the trendy or quick solution, if you can help it. That's all I'm trying to say. Good artwork is good artwork. Now and 10 to 20 years from now, it's still good artwork. That's the niche you want to be in. I had a professor tell me that, and that's good advice. Something I did, you know, 7 years ago, people still like it today, because I don't try to do just because everybody's doing it this way. I don't just necessarily try to fit in that box. That's just my personal philosophy of it. So, again, I'm going to just say the quick way, and we can do downloads in. I'm just telling you a quick and easy way for anyone who never touched a Drupal theme, how do you get started? You basically take Granddaddy Garland, and you basically copy that. This is the wrong slide. The things you want to remember when you're looking at getting started with from the design phase into the actual theming phase is that you want to, in a normal design process with outside of the CMS, you would, you know, just create something and not worry about it, because you will always have a development staff and they will do it just to your liking, right? You don't have to worry about limitations, you just go and free in the design. Well, Drupal works the other way around. When you work in a Drupal shop, you're working with a Drupal system, you have to actually go download and download all the functionality ahead of time and play with that functionality first, then consider that, you know, in your design. The whole goal in Drupal, the Drupal world is kind of don't reinvent the wheel, kind of reuse. That's the whole point. And at best, that's the way that you should work when you're considering a Drupal design. It's not that you can't create something new. It's just that consider what's there, because like you said it. He said it. He said, you know, that's the whole point. It's a community, right? So you have to take advantage of the community, so you don't have to create something new and support that. And that's billable hours. Sometimes you can't get that exotic in the Drupal design. Again, use the built-in features, and the only way you'll know that is you have to download Drupal and play with it to know what is and isn't built in and what you will have to create custom. Now, for your clients, this will save you time and money because really they just want it to work. And if you tell them at the outset, hey, there's some contributed things or contributed modules that we can use and leverage, and that'll save you money and it'll save you time because you could just get that buy-in. So again, I'm gonna stress this point. Think of how you can reuse, reuse, and reuse what's already available to you as opposed to create something new. And when in doubt, always work closely with a specialist or a company. If you have questions, Drupal community at large, you know. I prefer you come to media kind, but you know, you do what you gotta do, you know, to survive. Right? Good plug. All right. That one got deleted. Well, I can actually show you that I've seen you a link actually. This Common Themes blueprint is one. It has it's a good base theme. And we can talk about base themes when we get into the question and answer portion more later. Main considerations in the Drupal design is, and I'm gonna say this again, just what CSS what do you have to produce or what is produced naturally, and you consider that and leveraging your code. You know, basically it's the same slide as before, more or less. Is how can you reuse it, and the only way you know is just to download it again. This is how I look at it. When I look at a design, this is what I'm really looking at. I'm not looking at the cuteness of it. Even if I did, I'm still not looking at it. I'm looking at what to save me time and what is repeatable. These yellow areas, these are repeatable objects. That's how you break up a design and you say, okay, well, I can use this, and you go into a block TPL, what they call block TPL, and you can specify for all right rail elements, I want to get the header and the footer. You know, you can specify that, and then it'll repeat each time. And this is how I'm looking at it. I'm looking at, this is a web form. You see, this is something that is a contributed module, and so I can tell the customer, we can do this, and no problem. Form's not a problem, you know, and I can go grab that module because I know what it does. So you have to become comfortable, and that's why I said you're half-breed, because you have to know both worlds. You have to know a little bit about programming, enough about how to spec the job, and enough about design to know what you can do to manipulate it to get it closer to the design vision. But again, see the repeatable items, J Carousel, these. I'm looking at it from what I know, what's known in the Drupal community, or what I know of, versus, you know, how you can leverage it.
Dante, so do you wireframe and sketch out blocks that you're going to use first before doing any of the visual design? Or
yes.
Do you usually jump in and just?
Oh no. We this is the typical process. Because you have the meeting. What do you want, Mr. Client? Well, I want this, and this, and this. Okay, that sounds like a good idea. I tell you what, do you mind if I block this out in what they call either gray boxing or what they call low fidelity wireframes? Heard that before, but it's basically just where you just grid out everything and put labels to where everything goes, and then this helps the client and you get a better idea of where things really should be. And then you scale that up a little bit and you go to what they call high fidelity or gray boxing. Gray boxing is just, you know, you're still using all gray, monochromatic gray scales, but it's a little bit more in depth. And then you may do what they call a high fidelity or a comp, what they call a design comp, which is more of a final design comp. Now, if you really want to get swanky, you want to do what they call paper testing, and you can sit somebody down in front of it and say, hey, if I wanted to fill out a form and contact the dealer, what do you do? And then you see what they do, and if they say, I don't know, I'm lost, then you know you didn't do a good job. Go back to the drawing board before you get to the development phase. It depends on time and budget and energy, but typically that's what you should do before you get up, you know, before it goes to the themer or the developer. I happen to be both at my organization, so sometimes I get to do both, sometimes I just get to do one. Doesn't bother me. Now, did I answer your question? So, so this is the whole process of creating the, and I'm going to run through this real quick. You take Garland from the, it's in the theme directory at the very, what they call core. You copy that into your sites folder and all, is it all/themes, that's a common place to put it. And then you change the name. And then you go in, you change the name to a theme name that you want, like say my theme. But typically it's a site name or some pattern you develop. And then you change, you hear me talk about the .info file, that's where all the brains of Drupal, so to speak, the wiring, you know, it tells Drupal where things are in the theme and where it should go look for certain, you know, CSS files and images. And you can change this because that's your visual representation of where your theme is. But in this file, in this garland.info file, you change it to your theme file, and then you go inside of that theme file and do a search and replace everything that has the Garland name or whatever contributed theme you want to use. It doesn't have to be God. It's a religious thing with them about Garland, so I just, you know, I do like this. But the point is, this is the process of anything. Anything you want to change. So some typical things I do for image preparation is this is a typical structure that I follow. You know, when you prepare an image, you take it from that design comp phase, and you move it over, and you start, you know, isolating those parts that we talked about, repeating parts. I typically say what type it is. Is the background image, is it an icon, is it a button, you know, what is it? Then I say, well, location, is it in the header, is it in the footer, is it in the right rails and the side rails, you know? And I tend to label what element it is it a gradient, you know, like what is it actually? You know, I give it some more descriptive name from background and location, I say what is it? It could be a corner cap, it's whatever it is. And then if it's a rollover intended for the menu, I do, a state. So, you know, like if it's a over or a hover or a rest or whatever. Now you say, well, why go through all the trouble? Just put the images in there because it's easy. Well, I look at it like this. If it gets separated from this folder, they're all grouped together. You know, birds of the same feather flock together. And the point to be made there is that it's easy. You don't even have to look at it long to know what's going on with the image. You don't have to think about it and go look at it. You can just pretty much tell what it is if you do it right. Give you some examples. This is a good image, right? Everybody knows what that is, right? You know it's a background image, you know it's in the header, it's some type of trim element, right? And it's some type of, I know immediately it's some type of active, a menu. It has some type of status, interactivity. Don't have to think about it, pretty much. Header trim. You see, it starts to get a little bit, well, okay, it's in the header trim, and then this guy. I don't like that. That was from leftover from me, from days when you couldn't put dashes in the servers, or I don't know. I really don't, you know, I tend to put a dash. That's just a personal aesthetic thing that I do. Now, this is, you know, this is just an ugly camera case. It's confused. It doesn't know where it wants to be or who it wants to be. It's just ugly. I mean, this is my personal, I'm a creative guy, so again, don't throw stones at me if you're a programmer. You know, this may look beautiful to you, but it doesn't to me. theme consideration, it's the same thing. This is important. This may trip people up. Use the correct dot type. Everybody knows what dot type is? Right by a show of hands?
Okay.
So anybody want me to explain what a dot type is?
No, I can just go ahead. I can look it up. I got Google.
Well, remember dot type. Well, and this may help. This may be a tip for just people who already know. Sometimes when you can't get a particular bug, it's because you may be using the wrong dot type, or this a dot type will actually throw particular types of bugs or throw the browser to different types of modes because you're using the wrong dot type. Use CSS to manage alternate page layouts when possible. That's another thing. I have some modules that I show you that you can, different ways you can manage layouts in Drupal, all kind of ways, but typically if you want to keep it all in the same, use CSS to manage the webs and whatnot. Another point is, be kind to your neighbor, meaning that if you work in a team or if you want to code it in such a way that people will understand it, that if you have to work with a group of people, you build it in such a way that they can understand it and ask you as little questions as possible, as few questions as possible. Just a couple of, I know you guys are CSS gurus. Just my personal preference, use M's or pixels or points. Now, there's no wrong using pixels because this is that. M's, they tend to expand or be measured by the X height of your font. So, it may not be as much of a problem today, but, like small browsers, we have to shrink the site down, it helps manage the site.
Can I ask a question about the previous slide you had up there, the bottom bullet point on there? You said only use inline CSS with things like jQuery and so forth. What's the reason for that?
Man, because if you're using inline CSS, inline CSS is when something is inline with the DOM, what they call it, document object model, is right in line with the HTML. The reason why is because this will really make you upset if somebody comes in afterwards and you're trying to fix something and it's in line and it's like you can get to it, but it's very cumbersome and it's very difficult to manage. You want to manage all your styling options inside of a document. That could be, if you do it in line, it makes it difficult because if a customer comes in and says, well, I want to change all the fonts to a serif. You have them sans serif, and you in line have put each block. You have said, okay, font family, and you did that. Guess what? You have to go back through and do a search and replace, and hopefully you find everything. But it's cumbersome when you can just put it at the top of your document and change it in one place, and then everything is inherited. That makes sense?
You also don't get caching unless you have it in a separate font.
There's another approach as well where you can split your style sheets out by the function. So you start with the reset style sheet and then group all your type elements in one, color in another,
yeah,
in the layout. And then that way, if you need to do massive changes to all the fonts, you've just got one style sheet to change, which works out really nicely.
Yeah, I've done both. I mean, I could tell you, at one project, I worked with 11,000 lines of CSS. And it was also in separate documents as well. And when you're trying to wrangle a huge site,
it is hard.
And they're all separate out, so you do have to leverage some things, structure. If I had to divide it, I would typically do structure and maybe style.
Yeah.
But it depends. Now this is particular style. I'm saying my particular style, but it works either way.
Definitely.
Because at the end of the day, you should be aggregating them down in. Yeah, I mean, aggregating meaning putting them all into one.
The performance module will group them all together. That's one of the reasons why it's really on Drupal. And for a lot of the inline, if you're doing CSS specifically for a one page, you might have one box on that page that you want to start differently, and you've got 10 other pages which it just bloats the style sheet having that code in there and it's not being used, then you can create a plug-in style sheet. So you do your base, yeah, reset color style, whatever, and then you can just plug in, you know, welcomeform.css, and it just has those pieces of code for that one bit.
Yeah, I mean, different use case. I mean, you can import, you know, in CSS at the very top, and kind of have them strung together using the import tag as well. To say the least, it's pros and cons to doing it. You know, it depends on your project. For a brochure site, for your daughter's wedding, I mean, if you can do, you do what you want, but I wouldn't recommend going through it. For those high performance sites, maybe, you know, it depends on the group you're working with, that may be a good solution, but it has its pros and cons. Any more questions about that? Can you take us? So typically, it's the way I do CSS, I prefix it with whatever the property or project name I'm working on. This helps cut down on namespace, space issues, from contributed modules, or it also creates a standard. So you know what you touched versus what somebody else touched. Because see, if you fast forward 6 months, you may be confused. You may go back in and say, well, like in your case, if you did CSS, assuming you became a Google
CSS. I have
a
cheat. It converts it to my Drupal. Right. I don't have to write the HTML codes.
Well, I'll just use as an example. If the person, in other words, you fast forward, you know right then where you, what part you had in it. There's no confusion, you know. It's just like any other standard that a contributed module may use. I rarely place it on one line. It's for humans, not for machines at the end of the day. So you're really not saving that much of code weight, especially when you aggregate it down, it won't matter anyway. So write it for humans and not machines. Always use shorthand. Shorthand is meaning like they have a way to combine code, instead of saying, okay, I want to use border height left and border, border weight left, and you can combine it all into one stream. You just use, I give you an example of what I mean by always use shorthand when I get to the next slide. Always indent code like you would any other language, meaning put inherited items underneath each other. So you can easily tell where things, how they are grouped on the page. And I typically tend to group them based on where they live on the page. I tend to put the CSS that corresponds to the header at the top, versus putting it down at the bottom. I always place in alphabetical order. And if you actually place in alphabetical order, you start to see that the intent, the writers, it almost appears as if they intended for it to be that ordered that way anyway. Sometimes, and you may think that this is really overkill, but your mind subconsciously works better when there's a pattern, and you can get things done a lot easier than if you just randomly, when you're thinking, okay, margin, border. But if you do it in the same place each time, it becomes easier to code and easier to manage because somebody behind you will know, oh, they always know where to look. Subconsciously, this is a subconscious tool to speed up your work effort. I'll give you a good example. Right? So I'm saying by inherited, you can tell exactly. This happens to be for, this is done for background image. I forget what property or what company this was for, but their initials were BG. And you would, if it's, UGA, use that. If it's Auto Trader, use Auto, whatever it is. Or if it's your own personal site and you just want to do everything under your company's name, put your initials so that way you know what you were involved in. I'm considering bad. It's all online. And I honestly, guys, sometimes you just don't have the time. I just do it as a habit, but sometimes you inherit other people's code, so wherever that code, you know, wherever I inherit, I just start my style from there. So at least I know where it's at. This is just a style.
Can you go back to the previous page for a second?
Okay.
So the original, okay.
So you can see, oh, this is the top level. Sometimes I put it in there. You know, I know it weighs down the code, but I put it in there because it'll speed it up later on when I may have to change it, and I just put an empty tag in there. You go.
If you have a many levels, then the re-implementation can be that. Maybe you make the code hard to read.
Oh, you could, but...
Are you intended because of the levels?
Well, I mean, from my experience, watch, you know, even a laptop, it never gets to the point where it's like a PHP script where it goes all the way out to the point where you have to scroll horizontal to get to it. I mean, I never have had to, you know, but there's always unique edge cases for everything. I tend to think that this is a cleaner way to read it, but again, if it's not for you or it's a difficult way to work, then it's just a, you know, it's a preference, it's a choice. But that's a good question. And this will work, it'll actually get a job done. I'm just saying it's just a way to read the code. Now, I do consider this just bad form in general. Me, I consider it bad form. And now, this is a case where you will have to scroll. I've seen guys literally put it all in one line, like, and they code like that. Like, man, they're just, and they're like, well, I'm saving all this space. They're like super programmers. I don't mess with them. They're like cyborgs. You get it done, but I'm not going to go in and edit your code because it's very difficult to read it after a certain time when you scroll. So, it's a good point you made.
Yeah, and once you want to do performance, it's going to do that for you.
It's going to do a performance. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So it really doesn't matter. That's why you should program for what humans and not for machines. I mean, it's my personal model.
Say you don't copy it first, then you do it. Do that little automatic shrinking.
Yeah. Yeah. And program for Jupyter bots. But so common techniques. Just basic. You mentioned reset. And this is a way to, for IE, for Firefox, for Safari, for Chrome, those are the four major ones. This is a way to say, hey, I want all you guys to play on the same level today, okay? And I'm going to tell you individually, I'm going to make all of you behave the way I want you to behave. So this is a way to do that. So this will cut down on the development time of fixing IE bugs. Not that you're not going to have it, because you know how IE, how IE does, but this will cut down dramatically back and forth if you program it correctly.
A lot of things already come with
the
reset.
Like Blueprint, Zen, DAO actually comes with it.
If you do a search for Eric Meyer, he's one of the first couple of DAOs as well. Eric Meyer first came up with the concept of reset style sheet, and he often adjusts it as well.
Yeah. And you know, Yahoo actually has a whole API for CSS and reset, so you can actually plug in there, and they're a pretty good resource if you're looking for a systematic approach. And you don't want to roll your own. You want to be, you know, radical like me. You know, somebody else's criteria, but. This is, now we just get into just typical, how do you turn, you know, little square tabs. This is just tips, how you turn square tabs around corners. Very simple. This is typically a link. This is typically what they call an LI tag or list tag. On the list tag, you put the image, and you can use the same image. You can either break it up or use the same image, but you say you make the image long enough where it couldn't possibly be that long anything. You know, you can make it three times the size of it. This little background image. And you cut that out of your document. Put that on the LI tab as a background. Then on the anchor tag, you send it and you float that, you know, if it's right here, right. You know, you you have this flush left against the LI tag, and then the anchor tag, you do the, take the same graphic, more or less, right? Or you could do a corner. You could take just one corner, and you would say, okay, I want you to be a background image inside of here, but I want you to flow it this way. And then the illusion is, will be that they align in there, you know, perfectly around corner. Now, when CS3 gets here, we really don't have that problem anymore. But this is, for now, the best that the browser can do to accommodate a creative's wild imagination. Because I know programmers tell me often, stop it. You know, they don't like doing, getting out there into a fantasy land, but because it's easier for them to do this than do that. But this is just a quick way to do it. And you can go on Enlist Apart. It's a pretty good site for CSS, more or less. And the last thing, just for SEO, is a trend, but it's a good trend, I dare say it, that it's below your menu, this guy, last in the document, and position it absolutely at the top. So, well, why would I want to go through the trouble? It's because, like you said, program for search box, or one of you guys said, program for the search box, this actually helps get the relative content higher on the screen, so it meets that content first, versus going through each of the menu items each time the page loads. You know, each time the box go through. It's just a SEO thing. I mean, will the box get down to this level? Yes. But you're just trying to help them out. You know, you want them to be your friend, so you try to make it easy.
Question.
Yeah.
It's also a good accessibility rule if you're trying to work for screen readers for people who are blind. Putting your menu last and then having a invisible anchor to jump down to that menu allows the screen reader to either let them go straight to the content of the page that they asked for or go down to the navigation. And so it provides the SEO and it provides good accessibility.
Yeah, that's excellent point. But visually, it's going to be up here, just so we don't get confused. We're not saying put it down there, you know, leave your menu at the bottom. It's in
structure.
In the structure, put it down at the bottom.
So you're stating that, like, my home, contact us, products, da-da-da, should be at the bottom of it as well, so I get higher rankings up on the site.
Structurally, when I say structurally, if you do a source lookup of your document, in other words, you see certain code in that document. What I'm saying is, for those who you hire to do the programming, you can say, hey, I want you to take this whole piece, and I want you to structurally put it at the bottom, but I still want you to visually position it at the top.
Okay.
So it's going to be here where it's standard trends to have a menu at the top.
So that the search engine can read that first headline and then that content.
Yes, exactly.
So that Windows results display, that's what's going to display first.
If you turn off CSS, which you can do with the web developer.
Just to clarify that, maybe make it a little more clear. The way I understand it, every time the search engine goes to a separate page on your at your site, you're always going to see that menu first, and that's what they're going to start thinking is important on your website, and that's what they're going to be weighing. By moving it to the bottom, the robots to see at the bottom, they see the content first on every page they go to, and they weigh that a little higher than they do your menu every single time.
Okay.
And by moving it back to the top using CSS, you're able to see the user then can interface with it at the top of the page.
The bots don't care about CSS, they only care about the HTML structure.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So if you ever want to see how your site looks to Googlebot or any of the other bots, you can run something like the Lynx browser, which is literally just text, no CSS, or you can just turn it off and see how it shows up without the CSS, and that gives you an idea of how your structure is set up.
There are also some websites you can go to that says, show me what my site looks like for a bot.
And if you have a command line, that's where you get to the links. I've been listening to you guys. I know these things. Yep, sir.
Likewise, if you have a three-column layout with a sidebar on the left and sidebar on the right, some content in the middle, it's nice because you can see content first.
You can do it with floats and lines.
Yeah.
All
right.
Okay. So, you know, it's a good tool, and I think you see a lot more people move to this standard, and you want to make sure you follow the right standards, right? Take advantage of the community. But, where to get help? There's a lot of places to get help, but this is just general. First, you want to get help at MediaCurrent.com.
That guide on how to use Drush.
Yeah, that's where you got it from.
I've been looking for a guide like that for 6 months.
All right.
It's in my Drupal book.
There you go. We're on the right track, guys. We're on the right track. And then you go to Drupal.org, okay? After you visit here, you go here. This is more for those who want to get into developing. And these are where you get some of your contributed themes and obviously the CSS. And this is video tutorials. And they have some really good, lynda.com has some very good tutorials that if you really are looking to get up to speed quickly, go there. I think this is information about.
39451?
Yeah, that's classic. Yeah. I'm about to go there with you. Yeah, it's classic. Well, I think it's a. I think that's.
The basic theme help.
Yeah, theme. Yeah, that's what it says. Basic theme help, info file, and Drupal books. Drupal for dummy. Wave it proud. Wave it proud. That's right.
For modules. For modules, DrupalModules.com, because they actually rate them on that site. You see how many people have used that module, what the issues are, and there's a real comprehensive guide to that.
Absolutely. Put that in there.
So you're saying with Garland you can pretty much produce anything you want. I've been thinking you have to find the right number of blocks for a thing as a base thing. Is that right? Because, you know, so what I want is, you know, several blocks. Right column, middle column, or I want two columns. I think Garland has three blocks, you know, but if I want a four, you know, just for example, well, should I find a base thing that has exactly right kind of blocks to start with, or can you create a new blocks with Garland?
Okay, well, you can't create new blocks. You mean columns, really, is what you're saying. You can, but that gets into needing to know more about Drupal. A good place to go would be a Xen or a
Fusion.
And that will lead you down the right path. But there's also another way that you can do the same thing. You can use panels. I was building up to it, and you beat me to it. You just couldn't hold it in. I wanted to say panels we have a panels expert. Chris, please stand up and talk about it. Please give everybody your wisdom. See, again, like I said, it's always the same thing. You know, you have to use the right tool that works with your situation. But I do have an example of what you can do with panels. And panels, you can create different columns as well. The other one is ThemeKey. You can use ThemeKey. Now, a programmer may tell you, no, that's just way overkill. It's like, why can't you just do that in the module or something? But you know what? As a creative guy, coming from non-programming, you know what, it's easy. It works. It doesn't cause anybody any headaches. I understand it. Do it, right? That's pretty much the basic, but you can use it. And I've seen, actually, this site here, believe it or not, support.com uses ThemeKey. You know how many layouts that they have themes that they see. A theme key works by creating different themes, and you can switch based on different rules, like like the URL, if it's a taxonomy, or whatever way you want to, identify. It uses that, and believe me, that site really tests my limit on theme key, but pretty much it works. So you go there now, you can see literally that the theme changes in some cases.
Where do you find information about
the theme key?
How do you find information about
that? Actually, I'm going to post this, and I have it already downloaded. So I'm just going to theme key, Drupal, to do a Drupal search, Drupal theme key. Let me see. I want to show you, that's technically the end of the presentation, but I do have a Drupal instance, so if anybody wants to just kind of ask questions, we can go from there.
Yeah, we've got about 10 more minutes, guys, if anybody has questions.
For the website, how many scenes in the design?
How many
scenes? See, like page scene, right?
Yeah.
That's one. Then you get some people are going to think maybe I have design scene for the blog, right?
Mm-hmm.
With different contents. Well, and how is it each scene going to like a match with each other to make the site look good?
So let me, I'm gonna ask it, and I'm going to re-ask you to make sure I got the right question. You asked me, how do I keep a design consistent from page to page, or is that what you mean?
How many scenes, say, from page to page, give me some specific given number?
How many things from page to page,
Oh, you mean the theme or just in general, like?
I'm thinking is, say, if you want to design thing, right, you may design thing per page. Maybe this block in the, for the content, right?
Mm-hmm.
And maybe a different, another type of thing, right?
Like on another
page.
So, like, if you go to one page, you want the block to change.
Right.
Different block.
How do you have this
condition?
Okay. Different blocks with different.
You can do it by specifying what page you want that specific thing to display.
Well, I mean, there are different ways. I say Drupal. This is Drupal. You can do what they call context. And you can decide, based on a particular set of rules, how a particular block will show up in different pages. Then you go and just do Drupal search for context. And you can do what the old-fashioned way now is do it through blocks, like in the Drupal core. That's just let me ask you. Before I do that, sir.
Yeah, one thing I can't figure out, how do you, when you design using, for example, Photoshop or Fireworks, that's what I use usually.
Okay.
It's only HTML, so how do you integrate this into Drupal, which is PHP?
How do I mix Drupal with
should you design Fireworks, for example?
Yeah.
It's all HTML, right? How do you integrate this in Drupal?
Okay, it's not as difficult as it appears to be, but what he asks is, if you do a design in Fireworks, right, and it's all in HTML, how do you integrate the HTML into the Drupal PHP, right? Well, the thing is that, just remember this slide. All right. Drupal prints out basic HTML, right? That's the starting point,
yeah.
Right? So you take, you go into your HTML,
yeah.
And you say you identify where, where you would want to put it in Drupal. Now this is what they call a Drupal block. Yeah. So say you create a block, and you say, okay, I want to put this HTML in that block. This is a simple way of doing it. But you want to put this HTML in that block, and you want to put, like you could edit the template file, and it's in PHP, and it has HTML, and you'll see it. They have the opening divs, and then they have that information there. It's in the, what they call block dot, you probably have to create for this rail a separate naming, a separate file type, but just for your experimental purposes, go into block.tpl.php, and you see the HTML, and then actually put some of that code, you're going to have to clip some of that code out and test it out there. And then you start to see all the blocks on your site have that similar code. And then from there, you can start making decisions on, you know, how you want to repeat it. I hope that answers your question. Does that make sense?
I've designed the whole page using what's one thing needed. So, and I've never worked this way with people.
Yes.
I'm trying to adapt it.
And the way you adapt is, like I said, you have to do it in reverse. You have to actually build the feature. It's a good idea to build the feature, put it on the page, and then see what it produces naturally, the code, and then try to map what you do to that, as opposed to building out HTML first and then trying to integrate it. You can do either way, but
to break and use pieces, I guess you can't use the whole.
Yeah, you can't. I mean, not typically. I mean, you can what they call repurpose it, but it's going to be you being a surgeon and taking different pieces and putting them in place.
It's one of the things. Regardless of what theme you use, there's core pieces of code. Like a block is always the same code. And so what I used to do when I was putting them together is you come up with your design, open up a simple template like Garland, open the template files and look at it, and you can figure out, you know, because PHP has an open tag and a closed tag and everything like that, and you just import where you want your blocks to go into your design. And it makes it fairly easy. It takes some practice, and you know, you may have to shift things around with CSS and whatnot, but it's usually not
the The blocks, what's the blocks, the template?
It's whatever. If you have a template, like a theme template, you've got the main pages, you've got the blocks, you've got all the different elements.
I give him a good okay. example. I don't want to interrupt you. I don't mean to interrupt you.
That's okay.
But I want to show. Okay, so I created this Drupal site called Easy Steps. So I'm going to go on my theme. And guess what? I downloaded some themes that are popular. But this is a typical theme that I created, right? Oh, now, you know, it's one thing, when the group that I work with allows me to, because everybody works differently, but sometimes, I like to separate my content out into folders. Some people say, well, that's just clumsy, I just really like to get to it, but this is for people who may not understand, you know, it's easy to break things out, and it's easy to find things later down the road when you're code gets a little bit too, you know, gets messy. But to answer this question, this is a Garland thing converted. You'll see this file. Find that file and you open it up. Okay. Oh, I gotta move it over. See that?
Yeah.
So, see how this is all blocks. This is a reusable template. All blocks on the site, because this is the default, this is at the base level, all blocks on the site will use this, right? And what you would do is take your code and you would morph it into this, you know, and you can, let's see if I can open this thing up. And that screen is live. What I'm doing is I'm enabling this thing. I want him to see something.
Can't you just cut out the question mark PHP if not indeed and put in some HTML there, just some text actually?
Yeah, yeah.
Show up in the blog?
Yeah, yeah, you can. I just wanted to show them also there are other options you can specifically isolate it. But let's say for test purposes, let's just do this. I see you. All right? Now, let's go. I have to pull up the site. Let me add a block to this. Let me actually add one.
We can't see if you're doing something else.
Well, no, yeah, I know. I'm actually, well, because I can't see it when I get it on here. It's too high. See, so I have to like, I'm out. Let me get it.
You know, on Windows, you can see
everything. Yes. Thank you. Tricky toggle.
Turn your thing into a circle. I'll come over to it.
Oh, man, I got an that for you. Don't worry about it. I know your name now.
Well, Dante's looking that up. How many, the Drupal.org, the new redesign? What's everybody, I got to take a quick poll.
I like it.
It's good.
Like it more?
Rob's good.
Digital, you more modern. Thumbs up?
I like parts of it. Parts
the ones
of it
reverted back to the old.
Oh, no. That website is so ugly.
I like the dashboard.
The dashboard?
I think the dashboard's nice.
I thought
it
was. What is it?
Yeah, well, the Drupal.org went through like a 3-year redesign.
The getting started is much better. I think for people that are just new to it, you can find everything that you need to find a lot easier than everyone.
They still need a module curation system set up so that people can rate modules and certain modules can obtain a gold star or something, especially if the community has sort of picked it as the future approach.
It's weird because
there used to be the site she mentioned is DrupalModules.com. It's really good, but they considered that like a conflict of interest. They didn't want a bunch of branches off of Drupal.org,
right.
So they didn't really support the project or anything.
I can tell you've been DVR and Avatar lately.
Well, it doesn't. Well, that's what I'm saying. It actually doesn't. It's really too small. This screen is the resolution. I can actually do this. But this resolution, I have to find the right resolution. In other words, it won't minimize inside of the area.
The only thing I can't see on this thing is if I see you.
You see it now?
There,
I see you.
Can't you put that code just in the block body?
Yeah. I mean, I was just showing them for example what you need to do.
Save it first.
Save it first.
Thanks.
Thank you.
He's in Drupal. He's asking what you were in. I said he's in Drupal. So he had great contacts with
the this whole admin right here. This is a admin theme that is called admin. Yeah, it's called admin. This is admin. This guy right here is admin. This is a combination of Tile and Rubik, and you just it'll actually download it for you once you download it. I think in the newer version it'll download it for you. It'll tell you whether to get it. But this is something I personally use. I like it. It works well for customers. You know, it helps them.
Now, this is mostly for CSS and HTML coding, right?
No, this is just for registration. Regular registration.
Instead of having like the black bar right up at the top of my screen?
Yeah, it's
right.
A different.
It's just different.
Oh, I need that. Leave that little old lip video riding. I got to get those vibe vocals out.
I don't like that line. You can actually control the size of that, though. So,
yeah. I actually have...
the site was built and said, here, learn these few things, and there you go. And
you need any help?
It is.
I need to get your card and everything, because I am like lost. I mean, you guys see. I mean, read the book, honey. Read the book. Look at the site. Read the book. I read the book. What's the book gonna do for me?
How often are you dropping straight down the TPL files and just editing all that?
Nowadays, I use panels sometimes, but it depends on project. It really depends on project and the way that we want to go with it.
For logging in?
We got views that we edit, block files. The main thing, I try to actually stay out of, I try to do that least bit of code, I attempt to show up at the ETL level, more or less. And I try to do everything in CSS.
So do you actually really start with Garland, or do you have a blank template that you
I just build it myself. I typically don't. Okay. I mean, this is...